So good afternoon, all the very guests and also the academy from both Chulalongkorn University and also from the Asahi Foundations. My name is Professor Assistant Professor Suresh Chaitanya Ramo from Faculty of Engineering, Chulalongkorn University. I'm very pleased to host this afternoon session for the para session 2. Before we start, I would like to introduce my co-chair as well, which is Miss Pon Pipran, right? Miss Pon Pipran, you in the room already? Okay, but because what has happened in this afternoon, so we have the videos that all of the academy who received the funding in the previous year. They have already recorded video on the research outcomes that they received from the Asahi Foundation grants, and that we run for 10 minutes and we have 5 minutes for Q&A, question and discussion. So in the we have about 7 speakers in this section. And Ms. Pon Pipran, you here now? Oh, Pon Pipran, sorry. Ms. Pon Pipran, you here now? Also, you here?
Yes. I can hear.
Okay, thank you. All right, so I would like to introduce the first speaker, Associate Professor Greenkai Mani Int. The topic that Professor Greenkai is going to talk is on the coal combustion products utilization for degraded soil improvement in non-province. Professor Greenkai is from the Department of Mining and Petroleum Engineering, Faculty of Engineering. So we have the video for 10 minutes of Professor Greenkai. Ms. Pon Pipran, please, in ready, share the video of Professor Greenkai, please. Professor Greenkai, welcome you to the session.
Oh, thank you very much, Cap.
So you had the video, right, I think? And first we you come and discuss in the Q&A. 5 minutes.
Okay. Thank you.
Ms. Pon Pipran, please, could you share the video of Professor Greenkai? Thank you.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Greenkai Mani Int. Today, I would like to present my work on coal combustion product utilization for degraded soil improvement in Nan province. The overview of this presentation is introduction, objectives, experiment, results, conclusions, and acknowledgement. Coal combustion products, or CCP, are the solid residue that remains after the combustion of coal within the furnace and are collected in emission control process. For this case, we will focus on bottom ash and fly ash. And based on American Coal Ash Association, we can use bottom ash in many ways, but only 0.1% of bottom ash used in agriculture, and that's why we have some more gap to develop bottom ash used in agriculture. And for soil amendment, when bottom ash is added to soil, it helps to enhance soil quality by adjusting the solid soil pH to improve soil texture and to increase water retention capacity. Moreover, bottom ash contain most of the essential plant nutrients, thus making it suitable as a resource material in agriculture. Therefore, the coal waste utilization for soil amendment is a better way to manage waste as well as to reduce the environmental impacts and increase the profit for the manufacturers. Degradation. Soil degradation is defined as the change in soil health status resulting in a diminishing capacity of the ecosystem to provide goods and services for its beneficiary. Soil degradation in Nan province, the cause of land degradation is mainly due to human activities such as green land for agricultural practice, deforestation by people, exploitation of marginal soils, and inadequate soil management practice. You can see from this sticker, we have deforestation and the soil quality will be lower. That's why we should have improvement of the soil. Then become the objective of this work to apply and evaluate the bottom ash from mammal power plant to improve the quality of the gated soil in Nan province and to determine the optimum ratio of bottom ash soil combination as well as to estimate the potential use in agriculture of bottom ash from power plant for the gated soil in Nan. The material used for the study is bottom ash obtained from mammal power plant in Lampang, and the gated soil is collected from Nan province. For this case, we can use natural fertilizer to grow plant in order to compare the result with that of normal soil and soil with other conditions. The reason we add fertilizer as well because the soil quality in Nan is very, very bad, and even the grass cannot grow. That's why we can add some fertilizer as a nutrient for soil. As you can see from this figure, is pH from soil from Nan is around 5.664, and bottom ash from mammal is 9.739. The experimental we do for this study will be soil texture, pH and EC measurement, and bulk density measurement. The equipment we can use is a pH meter to measure pH and EC, and the soil texture is used to measure the percentage of clay, silt, and sand by using hydrometer and follow the ASTM standard. The operating condition for this work is we can use acid soil and bottom ash and mix them together with the ratio of 5% to 30% of bottom ash. And this figure shows the result of effect of bottom ash on soil texture. We use the hydrometer to measure the amount of silt, clay, and sand, and put it in this triangle. This triangle will tell you what kind of soil texture you have for sample. For the beginning, we use the gated soil is fall into the clay range, and for sand is bottom ash is soil texture is sand. When we combine them together, we can change from clay to clay loam or sand to clay loam, depending on the ratio. You can see that for this figure is 5% is not that good because it's still clay. But when we mix with 10, 20, or 30%, the quality is will be enhanced. And that's why it can come out to be a clay loam. Effect of bottom ash on pH, you can see that is it clear that pH of sand, of soil can increase. And especially at bottom ash, 10 and 20%, because this range can fit well for plant growing. And for EC, EC represents the salt in soil. We don't need to use salt, too much salt, but bottom ash has a lot of EC value. But soil, we have less EC value. When we mix together, then with the ratio, optimum ratio, then 10 and 20% of bottom ash can help to increase EC and to fit well with the plant growing. But 30% is quite high and is not good for plant growing as well. And for bulk density, you can see that bottom ash have lowest bulk density. When we mix them together with soil, then we can increase, we can decrease the soil bulk density to fit well with the soil plant growing. And that's why is when we select to further study here in the growing plant, we will select at 10 and 20% because 30% and 5% is not that good. It's not good enough. The best one is 10 and 20%. And that's why we use corn. Corn is grow in Nam, the main agriculture in Nam. And you can see that we use S stand for soy, SM is soy and fertilizer, VA is bottom ash. That's why we use bottom ash, 10 and 20%. And we have fertilizer as well. From the figure, you can see that at 10 and 20% with fertilizer, even or soy, the corn can grow easily and higher compared to the rest of the condition. And this one is showing the quality of corn when applied bottom ash in there. You can see that is for soy only, we have very small and the completion is not good. But when we apply bottom ash plus fertilizer, we can have corn is the quality of corn is much better. Even we have only fertilizer, only fertilizer can help the corn quality. But when we mix soy with bottom ash at 20%, you can see that for all cases, we have corn growing is our corn product is very good, and the completed and the height of the corn is much better. For the root system as well, we have soy with fertilizer. The root is not that good compared to bottom ash at 10 and 20%. Especially at 20%, is the root is go further or is longer, and we have a smaller root more, and then we can go and have a high product of bottom of the corn with bottom ash and fertilizer. From this work, we can conclude that bottom ash can improve soil property such as pH, potency, and soil texture. And the application of bottom ash can improve soil texture from clay to clay loam at ratio from 10 to 30% by weight, and adjust the pH value of soil to fit well for plant growing, and decrease the bulk density of soil and our ratio at our ratios to have more space for air in soil. And the quality of soil, bottom ash, and fertilizer has been improved. And the corn products, including root system, can are much better compared with original oil. From this research, it is also helpful for environment on waste management and cost reduction on waste disposal and effective land use. And the next project to work for this bottom ash is the application of bottom ash for degraded soil improvement in real corn field in Nam province. And we have the project called Lak Pa Nam, which means care for Nam forest project. To recover forest, we have a goal tree. Okay, and I would like to acknowledge the 2018 Overseas Research Grant from Asahi Glass Foundation for financial support, and the Memo Power Plant Electricity Generating Authority of Thailand, or EGAT, for bottom ash sample. And thank you very much for your attention. If you have any question, please feel free to ask.
Thank you very much, Professor Pinkai, for a very nice presentation on the topic of your work. I would like to ask for any questions in the panels or in this room. If you would like to discuss with Professor Pinkai, please put your hands up or possibly just unmute your microphone. Okay. While we are waiting, I have a very general question, Professor Pinkai. So your conclusion, you're saying that with the three component, one is soil, of course, which is degraded. The other is a mammoth, which is the bottom ash, and you have the fertilizers. So by looking at the result that you present in the last couple of slides, it seems from the result that the virtualizers have a very high impact on the quality of the soil. Right. So by looking at the result that you present, if you see, you show the length of the root from the country, and it's show very clear that when you increase the percentage of the fertilizers, the root of the trees start to be longer very significantly. Can you give the comment on this? Well, which component between the bottom ash and the fertilizers, and why is happening like that way? Thank you.
Okay. This one is the reason that I put or add fertilizer, because we want to see the first thing is quality of soil is very bad. Even grass cannot grow. Then that's why is we add some small amount of fertilizer. It's just 30 grams of each, the same thing with all the cases. And you can see from the difference between original soil and soil with fertilizer, we have seen the different even in the root system. But when we add more bottom ash, 10 or 20%, you can see that the root system is quite clear that we have longer root and small root, we have more. And even the size and the shape, size, the length, or the completeness of the soil product is bigger, is better, much better compared to original soil or even original oil or soil from fertilizer. Yeah, that's why is we add this one to increase the soil quality. Actually, bottom ash is not fertilizer. Bottom ash is just conditioner to improve the soil quality. If you need a nutrient, then it should have some from fertilizer. This is the reason, and we can have the sample to compare for all the cases with and without fertilizer, and then we can see the difference.
Thank you, Professor Pinkas. Okay, so what we anyone would like to ask Professor Pinkas?
If anyone have any question, please feel free to ask.
Yes. Okay, we have about 2 minutes left. So I would like to ask about your future extensions. You mentioned that you want to use the result of your research to treat the land in Nam province, and that is really dry. And of course, when looking at the area of the land is so huge. So in terms of the economical issue, do you have a problem with that? Because I'm not really sure how much of the mammoth fly ash we have, and is that going to be enough to treat the province that you plan to do so?
Yes, actually, bottom ash right now is they don't do anything about bottom ash. If you produce bottom ash 100%, 98% is waste, and they some company had to pay 500 baht per ton to get rid of this waste. That's why is we focus only on bottom ash. Fly ash, actually they have more, but they can use with something else, especially for construction add in gypsum to compensate the gypsum or less amount of gypsum consumption. But bottom ash is different. Most of bottom ash is waste. That's why is we can use the waste and take it to add the value of this waste. They have huge amount. When I asked for the bottom ash, they said, oh, please take it.
Yes.
And that's why is the point is from the main point is the length or the distance between mammoth and Nan, because it's quite far, then you have high cost about the transportation cost. Here's the problem. Okay. But the rest is easy.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor Pinkai. And I'm very sure that all of us in the room, and we enjoy your talk, and of course we see the very good application of your work. Thank you very much, Professor Pinkai.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Yes. We move on to the next presenter. Will be presented by Professor Pisanupong Kanchanapayong from Department of Geology, Faculty of Science. The topic that Professor Pisanupong will talk is on the application of EBSD to petroleum-related strike strip zones in Thailand. So we have Professor Pisanupong with us here. So once again, we have the recorded presentation from Professor. So we are ready now. So please. So we can, yeah, thank you.
Hello, everybody. My name is Pisanupong Kanchanapayong from the Basin Analysis and Structural Evolution Research Unit at the Department of Geology, Faculty of Science, Chulalongkorn University in Bangkok, Thailand. Today, I would like to present my research of the application of EBSD to petroleum-related strike slip zones in Thailand for the 29th Special Chulalongkorn University and ASEAN Glass Foundation Seminar 2021. This is online event take on 25th August 2021. This research has a keyword of crystallographic peripheral orientation strike slip zone and Thailand. For the previous research, I will start for the Polachan et al. 1991. This research is about the petroleum basin forming of Thailand. For the left picture, you can see the black area that are the petroleum basin lying in the north-south from northern Thailand to the southern Thailand, both onshore and offshore in Andaman Sea and Gulf of Thailand. The right picture is the tectonic that's related to this petroleum forming. You can see the Indian compression to the Eurasian, including Thailand. For Thailand, you can notice the line in the northwest, southeast, and the line in the northeast, southwest. For the next picture, I will zoom to the area of Thailand. It is the Gulf of Thailand, and this is Bangkok. You can see the northwest, southeast line called the Mapping Fault and the Chirapakoda Fault in this area. The Chirapakoda Fault continues to the Gulf of Thailand on the right picture to this. And in the south of Thailand is Ranong Fault and Krongmari Fault. This is the general view of this zone. In this study, I will focus on the Chirapakoda Shear Zone. So the next picture will zoom in this area. For the Chirapakoda Shear Zone in the Western Thailand, you can see the black area present for the Melonite. The Melonite is the rock that changed from the movement of the strike slip system. In this picture called ductile shear zones, this arrow represents for the left lateral movement or sinusoidal movement. This research aims to understand the behavior of this movement. For the methodology, I used the equation from the Pashia and Tro in 2005. This equation see in this picture has a cos theta equal to the WK. WK is the kinematic vorticity number. If WK is zero, that means the behavior of the area was changed by the PO shear. And if the WK is equal 1, that means the area was changed by the simple shear by this picture. And if between 0 and 1, it means mixing of simple shear and pure shear, we call general shear. So to know the WK, I have to find the theta to use the cos theta. The cos theta was found by this model. This model, you can see the foliation plane and the ISA1 and ISA2. That means instantaneous stretching axis 1 and 2. With this foliation, you can see the delta and beta. For this model, I have to know the delta and beta. The delta find by the orientation of the shear preferred orientation like this. This is the quartz mineral lying in this trend, and I have to find the delta. And for the beta, I have to find by the angle between the foliation and this line. This line is perpendicular to the center girdle of the C-axis fabric. So this C-axis fabric, I have to find the quartz CPO or crystallographic preferred orientation. To find the quartz CPO, first I plan to use the EBSD or electron backscatter diffraction at the University of Tokyo in Japan. But because of the COVID-19, this instrument cannot operate until now. So I switched to the USTAT microscope at the Chulalongkorn University to find the quartz CPO. Both instruments can find the quartz CPO, but EBSD is faster and USTAT microscope is a very slow method. After that, I go to collect the sample in the field. In this picture, you can see the rocks called quartz myronite. It records the line. We call the stretching lineation like this, or like this, you can see the line. This line effect from the movement of the area. After that, I cut it to the thin section and measure for the delta angle. In this six sample, you can see the angle is about 12, 13 to 24. And for the beta angle, I have to measure from the line that perpendicular to the center girdle to the foliation. You can see the angle is between 10 and 20 from all sample of this area. After that, I have to summarize data in this table. The left column, you can see the delta of all sample, the beta, and the summary of the delta and beta angle to find out the theta by this model. After I got delta, then I know the WK of all sample. After that, I have the average of the number by 0.93 plus minus 0.5. For the conclusion, this research showed the delta angle about 12 to 24, the beta angle about 10 to 20, and the kinematic vorticity number from 0.88 to 0.99. with an average of 0.93 plus minus 0.5. You can see the number 0.93 is very near 1. So I conclude that this area was changed by the sinusoidal simple shear like this. That means the petroleum basin in Thailand related to the stress-lift movement by the sinusoidal simple shear. This result can use to develop the idea of petroleum basin in Thailand. This is the reference of my research. And last, I would like to acknowledge Chulalongkorn University and the SME Class Foundation. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Pisanupong, for a very nice talk on your outcome. I would like to ask any question that you'd like to discuss with Professor Pisanupong in the panel. Okay. Also, I have been informed by the organizers that we have been delayed from the starting because in the main session, it's really nice presentation and it's been delayed. Maybe just a quick question, Professor Pisanupong. Even though I'm not in the area of the geologist, but in our civil engineering applications, we also use the information on the slip zone and so on in our earthquake information. Is it can be used as well? Because when there is a slip and a strike zone in some of the land areas, and how is it going to affect in general?
Yes, you can use it applying for the construction material, for example. But because of the Thailand is really, really high erosion, there is not the good evidence at the in the field. So, and the episode of the movement was developed in a really long time. So in my research, I try to know the number, but my number is occur maybe in the past, but the number we would like to know is the present day number. But because of the present day number is not easy for the everyday. And so now I moved in the long time ago to understand first, and then I have to collect more data to know all of the behavior. Yes, maybe my further research to know about it.
Thank you.
It will improve. Yes.
Yeah, I'm sure that we will have a very fruitful result from you in the future, and that will impact on the field. Thank you very much, Professor Pisanupong. And I would like to move further and. Before we go there, please join me to thank Professor Pisanupong for his very nice talk. Thank you very much, Professor.
Thank you very much.
Okay, we move on to the next presenter. Now, the next presenter is from Associate Professor Pichai Chong Wasikun, from my Department of Civil Engineering, Faculty of Engineering. The talk that Professor Pichai would like to share with us is on the utilization of bacteria for self-healing concrete. And we have Professor Pichai with us here. And once again, we have a recorded presentation from Professor. So we are ready now. So please go ahead before we have a discussion. Thank you.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Pichai Chongwasakun. And the title of my presentation today is Utilization of Bacteria for Self-Healing Concrete. At early ages, the fresh concrete is prone to shing when exposed to hot, dry, and windy weather conditions. The shingle crack is the most common cause of cracking in concrete structure. And this figure shows the shingle crack. And recently, there is new technology called the self-healing concrete. Self-healing concrete is a concrete that has ability to heal the cracks itself by adding some substance such as the bacteria into concrete during the mixing. And the crack healing is due to microbially induced carbonate precipitation or MICP process. For MICP, urease producing bacteria have been widely used because of the high productivity of calcium carbonate precipitation. And I will explain a little bit about the MICP process and how the bacteria can close the crack. The urease generated by the bacteria can catalyze the hydrolysis of urea, as shown in this equation. After that, the carbonate ion here can react with the calcium ion from healing agents or concrete itself to deposit the calcium carbonate for crack filling. And objective of this study is to investigate the self-healing performance of concrete subjected to shingle crack. And next, I will explain the experimental program. I'll start with the material we use. We use Portland cement type 1, the river sand, and the water. These three combination is the normal material for making the mortar. And for forming bacteria obtained from Bacillus spelicus LMG222257 was also used. The bacteria will prepare to be in the spore form, then it will be encapsulated by extrusion and freeze drying technique, and then we will get the microcapsule as shown here. This is the microcapsule contain the spore of the bacteria inside. The size of the microcapsule is approximately 1 millimeter, as you can see here. And during this process, I have to give a special thanks to these two persons, Professor Suchet and Professor Vipulak, for their help. And the reason why we have to encapsulate the bacteria spore is because we have to prevent the bacteria spore to be damaged during the casting process of the concrete. And we have the bacteria like this. Then we encapsulate it and we mix with the concrete. After the crack happened in the concrete, this microcapsule will be broken and the bacteria will go out and do the MICP process. And this slide shows the mixed proportion. We have four cases. The first one is the control mix without any bacterial spore or nutrient, just normal mortar containing cement, sand, and water. And the second mix is the S0. In S0, we didn't put the bacterial spore, but we put the nutrient. S0.5, we put 0.5% of the spore with the nutrient. And the nutrient, this nutrient is the nutrient for the bacteria, which is the yeast extract, urea, and calcium nitrate tetrahydrate, which is the calcium source for MICP process. And their contents were shown here. And the last mixture is S1. We put 1% of the bacterial spore with the nutrients. So we have the bacterial spore as the parameter. We have 0.5 and 1%. And after we cast, we mix the concrete and we put it in the mold. We have two sides of the specimen. The first one is the cube specimen with this side. We use it as the specimen for the compression test. We're going to test the compressive strength from this specimen. And the second one is the specimen for the shingle crack. This is the size of the specimen. After we cast the specimen for the shingle crack, we put it in the environmental chamber in order to control the wind speed and humidity inside. After that, about 12 hours, we will get the shingle cracked as shown here. This is the picture of the top surface of our specimen. And after that, we do the water curing for MICP process. We will pour the water on the specimen surface every day. And at the same time, we will take a picture of the specimen as shown here. We have to control the light as well because we're going to use the picture to calculate the crack width and the crack area. And here is the result. The first one is the compressive strength. This graph shows the compressive strength of four mixtures. The control one, S0, S0.5, and S1. And you can see that the compressive strength of mortar decreases when the nutrient is added because the yeast extract in nutrient delays the hydration process. In addition, the addition of bacterial capsule increases the permeability and thus the strength of mixtures decreases. The effect was more pronounced for the specimen made with 1% of bacterial spore. The compressive strength was decreased about 56% compared with the control mixed without any nutrient and bacterial spore. Next, we move to the the crack healing efficiency. This picture shows the picture of S0 mixture. At day 1, day 7, day 14, day 21, and day 28. This is the crack, and this value shows the crack width in millimeter. For the specimen added, the nutrient only, or S0, the maximum crack width was 0.79 millimeter, as shown here. And the maximum crack width Q at 28 day was 0.28. As shown here, there is some crack remain after 28 day. Next is specimen with 0.5% of bacterial spore and the nutrients. The maximum crack width at day 1 was 0.82 millimeter, and the maximum crack width heal after 28 day is 0.74 millimeter. You can see that. The crack can be closed after 28 day. This slide shows the crack healing efficiency of the S1 mixture, which is the specimen with 1% of bacterial spore and nutrients. The maximum crack width at day 1 was 0.8 millimeter, and you can see that after 3 days, all of the crack can be closed. So the shingle crack width up to 0.8 millimeter was still after only 3 days of healing. And when we plot the healing time with the crack healing area, as shown in this figure, we can see that the crack healing area increased rapidly during the first 7 days. However, there is a little gain in the percentage of crack healing beyond 7 days. And the percentage of crack healing increased significantly as 0.5 bacterial spore were added compared with S0 case. And the shingle crack formed in S1 mixture was completely filled after 3 days of healing. Conclusion, the addition of bacterial spore increased the rate of crack healing in the early age stage. The highest healing efficiency of MICP was found in the mixture made with 1% bacterial spore. The shingle crack was completely closed after 3 days of healing. And the third one, due to the negative effect caused by microcapsule or yeast extract in nutrients, the compressive strength of specimen contained microencapsulated bacterial spore and nutrients decreased by up to 56%. And This research was supported by the Asahi Glass Foundation. I would like to express my gratitude to the Asahi Glass Foundation for the research fund. And the output from this research project, we have already published two publications. The first one is the journal paper in top 10% ranking database, and another one is one domestic conference. And that's all for my presentation. Thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Picha, for a very nice talk and very productive outcomes. I would like to ask any question in the panel, please? Would you like to share the discussion with Professor Picha? Okay. We have maybe 1 or 2 minutes. I would like to ask about maybe just a general questions. So according to Professor Picha, according to your summary, you're saying that when we have the bacteria mixed in the concrete, it's drop the strength by half. So it means if we have to design the new building or some of the infrastructures, we have to over-design the strength then, so that will be compensated for the price we pay on the strength. Right. So what will be said in the verifications?
Yes, that's right. Actually, the first target for our self-healing concrete, we aim for using for the non-structural member, which means the member that didn't resist the load, for example, the wall, right? But in the case that we would like to use, it's for the structural member. Maybe we have to do, as Professor suggests, that we have to decide a mix to compensate the reduction due to the addition of the bacteria. Yes, and the cost may be a little bit higher. Yes.
And how long the bacteria stay with the mortars? How long will we stay in the...
Yes, since we encapsulate it in the microencapsule, so we believe that it can stay longer as long as it haven't broken out of the capsule. It's still in the spore form and can live very long, according to my knowledge from Professor in Department of Environmental Engineering. Yes, but we do not have the evidence yet that when we embedded our microcapsule in the concrete, for example, 1 year, 2 years, or 5 years, what will happen? Maybe we will consider to do it in the future.
Very, 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 very proud of my colleague, and really thanks for your talk.
Thank you very much.
Any question, please? Okay, so possibly we move on. And thank you very much, Professor Picha, again. And please, in the room, join me to thank Professor Picha for a very nice upcoming talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
The next presentations will be given by Associate Professor Vithit Bansuk, once again from Department of Civil Engineering, Faculty of Engineering. The topic that Professor Vithit will come and share with us is appraisals of corrosion degree and structural property of reinforced concrete beams using mill cut steel fiber concrete. We have Professor Vithit with us here, and we just maybe looking at watching the recorded lecture first, and then we have the question. Thank you very much, Professor Vithit. Okay, please go ahead.
Hello, everyone. Thank you very much again for this chance from Asahi Glass Foundation. The topic of my talk today will be appraisals of corrosion degree and structural properties of reinforced concrete beams using mill cut steel fiber concrete. My name is Vithit Bansuk from Department of Civil Engineering, Faculty of Engineering, Chulalongkorn University. The outline of my presentation will be 5 topics. Start with introduction, objectives, experiments, results and discussion, and then conclusions. Let's start with the introductions. Why does steel corrode in concrete? Normally, concrete is alkaline, and the alkaline condition of concrete protects steel from corrosions. But the corrosion of steel can take place because for example, after a process of carbonation or chloride attack, that can break down the passive layer of the steel bars. So this chemical reaction can happen. So steel lost the electron and the lost electron go to water and oxygen, then this is the corrosion that happened. So if you will compare the beam, normal beam and the colored beam after 27 years, this I correct from the literature, we found that if the corrosion takes place, our beam will decrease in the capacity. Okay, and also the ductility beam also decrease. As you can see from the graphs, the pictures. And also we found that the bond capacity of the steel and concrete also reduced. Okay, so also they changed the failure mode of the concrete. In the case with no corrosion, so the failure mode of concrete will be crushing of compressive concrete right here, or the failure of the tensile bars here in the bottom part of the beams. But if you have the corrosion of the steel bars, the failure mode will be changed to spalling of the concrete covers or the failure of tensile bars. So the problem is how the engineers will deal with these problems. So one of the idea is to introduce the fibers into the concrete. We call the concrete that have a fiber as a FRC or fiber reinforced concrete. It's concrete plus fibers. We have a new name, it's a fiber reinforced concrete. The fibers is a short fiber, as you can see here. So we have a steel fiber, glass fiber, carbon fiber, or polymers or natural fibers. So in this research, I decide to use steel fiber to use in the concrete. So the shape of the steel fiber, as you can see here, we have various shape of the steel fibers. It's a straight, smooth surface, or it have a hook at the end, or it have a shape, many shape like this. Okay, why fiber was used in the concrete? So if you use a fiber, you can reduce the crack, you can control the brittle process. Okay, you can resist the tensile stress and you can increase the ductility of the beams. Okay, the objective of this study is we would like to know the behavior of the first concrete beam after we put the steel fiber into the matrix, and we will test a static load. Okay, what's gonna happen? And we want to know the relationship between the flexural load and displacement of the colored beam at various degree of corrosions. Okay, so what we will do, we will see is a crack pattern of the concrete beams and at the various corrosion degree. And this data can be used for the develop the simulation models by the computers in the future to predict the flexural behavior of RC beam using this steel fiber in the future. Okay, let's see what we are doing and what we did in the experiment. So we have the beam, you can see here, the length allowed 3 meters. Okay, so the width, the length is, 1.3 meters. And the length of the fiber is 32 millimeters. The width is 2.6 millimeters. And aspect ratio around 40. And tensile strength is very high, higher than steel bars, more than 700 megapascal. So this is a mil cut steel fiber we put in the concrete. This is the beam that we use in the test. And we vary the mat proportion of the concrete, as you can see here. So without concrete, without the fibers, and add 0.5, 1%, and 1.5% of fibers into the matrix. The water to cement ratio is keep as 0.4. Okay, the slumps of the concrete is allow 14 centimeters. Okay, we have total 12 beam in this test. Okay, as I told you before, the length of the beam is 1.4 meters. The size the dimension of the beams is shown here. Okay, this is a picture that we did in the labs. We provide the steel reinforcement. We cast the concrete, and this is a specimen of 12 beam that after we cast the concrete, and we apply the level of corrosion at two level, 2% and 5%. And then we perform the static test. As you can see here, we made a beam and then we put the beam into two support and then put the load on top of the beams. Okay, so we collect the load diffraction curve and crack pattern of the beams. Okay, this is a technique that we use for the corrosion experiment. So we have steel bars. We protect some part with epoxy, and we put it with a wire. And we, as of course, we cannot wait for many years to wait for the beam to be corroded. So we have to accelerate the beam by attach them into the power supply and use the electric power to accelerate the corrosion level into 2 to 5%. Okay. And this is the results. So the first result is after the beam have the corrosion, we take out the steel bars and measure the mass loss of the bars. So we found that, okay, the actual corrosion that we found is around 2 and 5%. Okay, but of course in the test, every test have the error. So the error is shown here. Okay, and then we try to find the relationship between the fibers and cracking. We found that, okay, when you have more fibers, okay, you have less crack width. Okay. And this is a crack pattern that we found in 2% of corrosion. With our fiber, we have some unique crack pattern. And then you have more fiber, you have less crack. You can see here, you have less crack. Okay. And then in a similar way to 5% of corrosion, so we have some crack pattern. You have more fibers, so it means you have lesser crack. Okay, it's also reflect on the capacity of the beam also. So you can see here, so in the case with our corrosion, so when you have more fiber, you have a little bit different in capacity of the beams. And it the result become easier to see when you have corrosion. In the case with corrosion, when you have more fiber, it means you can help beam to become have a more capacity and it have better performance. As you can see here, this is without fiber, you beam have a very less capacity. But if you have fiber, in the case of high corrosion, you also can maintain the load of the beams. Okay, and in the case of in the case with no fiber with a corrosion, so we have different in capacity of beam in all cases. Okay, in all cases, and the crack pattern is different. After you have the functional test, you can have the different crack pattern as you can see here. Okay, so this is a really important results. And come to the conclusion, we can see that, okay, when you have the fibers, you can reduce the crack, you can increase the beam capacity in the case with and without corrosions. Okay, and from the result that you get here, as I told you before, so we can use the results as the database that we can simulate this kind of a test again in the near future. Thank you very much for your kind attention. And thank you very much for the chance. Please chant again. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Wittig, for the outcome, the talk of your outcomes. In the panels again, do you like to ask or give some comment to Professor Wittig? I believe this topic is very, very important, especially for the offshore structures, right, and infrastructure as well. Professor Wittig, perhaps could you please give some comment on the price that is cost to have the fiber added to the concrete? Is it a lot, or is it worthwhile to do so in terms of the economical issue?
Yes, thank you very much. Okay, about the price, of course, when you add some fibers, okay, your concrete become more expensive. But in this case, I chose these fibers because it's a normal technologies that we can produce in ASEAN country.
Yes, frozen deep.
In our neighboring country, Vietnam, okay, it becomes much cheaper. I cannot tell you the price yet, but it's cheaper than the fiber that we did use in the past. Okay, and to reduce the total cost of these materials, we have to reduce some steel bars that we are using, so it can compensate the total price of the concrete. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Professor. We lost you a bit in the middle, but I think to cap on what you present is in our regions, it's tend that we try to use the fiber to enhance the strength of the concrete and also in terms of durability as well. Right, to be concluded, or you just give a comment on.
Yes, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor Vitti. Any comment, please? Okay, so if no comment, so maybe we move on again to the next presenters. And please join me to thank Professor Vitti for this talk and also the discovery on the concrete fields.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Vitti. The next talk from Assistant Professor Pani Biladis from the Department of Chemistry, Faculty of Science. Professor Biladi is going to talk on the non-covalent functionalization of graphene oxides for photocatalytic applications. But we hear Professor Pani is here also here as well. So we listen to your talk first, and then we have some very brief discussion. Thank you very much, Professor.
Sawadee-ka. Hello, everyone. It's my pleasure today to tell you about a research project in my group that was kindly supported from the Asahi Glass Foundation. And my research project is about the development of photocatalyst based on graphene oxide using non-covalent interaction. So first, let's get to know with our key player here, graphene oxide. Basically, this material is an sp2sp3 carbon network that are decorated with several types of oxygen-containing functional groups. It can also be modified or functionalized by several pathways. It also exhibits very interesting reactivities and various properties that are suitable for many, many applications, including catalysis. And here are examples of reactions mediated by graphene oxide. It was also shown from the DFT calculation that the epoxy groups on the graphene oxide surface can serve as an active site for C-H bond activation. In addition, graphene oxide has been used in alcohol oxidation. It was also demonstrated in both experimental as well as computational studies. However, high pressure or temperature, as well as a large amount of catalyst were necessary. So in order to lower the activation energy of graphene oxide, we propose to introduce these porphyrin molecules to our system. With high absorptivity, chemical stability, and easy modification, this porphyrin derivative is an excellent choice for our study. However, the question is, how are we going to introduce these light-absorbing molecules to our graphene oxide? Well, there are many, many ways to do so, but we are particularly interested in non-covalent interaction because of its simple synthetic procedures. And in this interaction, the second component can interact with graphene oxide by pi-pi interaction, hydrophobic interaction, hydrogen bonding. And as an inorganic chemist, we are also curious to see if the interaction of oxygen functional groups on graphene oxide to the metal ions in metal complexes can affect the reactivity of the materials or not. And this is an overview of our study. We chose to non-covalently functionalize graphene oxide with the porphyrin derivatives, which is tetraphenyl porphyrin or TPP and zinc TPP by a sonification, by a simple sonication method. And after we got the composite, then we will further study and investigate the photocatalytic activity toward alcohol oxidation. Now let's move on to the experimental section part. For the composite preparation, we just simply mix the graphene oxide with porphyrin derivatives and then sonicate the reaction. We also vary the amount of porphyrin loaded in this study. After we got the composite, we first characterize the material by UVB spectroscopy to confirm that we have the porphyrin molecules in our materials. And as you can see that the story bands of both porphyrin derivatives was shifted and broadened. And this change indicates the interaction between the porphyrins and graphene oxide. We further confirm this interaction by fluorescence titration. So as you can see, upon addition of graphene oxide to the porphyrin derivative solution, the fluorescence intensity was quenched in the presence of graphene oxide, which again indicate the interaction between porphyrin and graphene oxide. Now that we know that we successfully synthesized the composite and can confirm the interaction between the two components, next step is to study the photocatalytic activity of the materials. So we mix our materials with the substrate and then irradiate the reaction for 24 hours under ambient condition. Then we analyze the products by proton NMR or GC. And to demonstrate the role of cooperative photocatalyst, we did a comparative studies toward the benzyl alcohol oxidation. And as you can see here, only the condition that we have graphene oxide and TPP as a composite and with the light irradiation that can give you the high yield of benzaldehyde product. It should be noted that without the light irradiation, no product was observed. From this result, it suggests the synergistic effect of these components. That means we must have the composite of graphene oxide with porphyrin derivatives and the light irradiation for the reaction to work. Then we further optimized the catalytic condition and found that this 4-to-1 ratio by weight of porphyrin over graphene oxide was the optimal ratio. And as you can see from this graph, you can see that these two composites exhibit very different reactivity, with graphene oxide TPP being a better one. And this result actually surprised us, because at first we thought that the oxygen functional groups on graphene oxide, which could potentially bind to the zinc ion in zinc TPP, which then provide a stronger interaction or additional interaction to the materials, would actually lead to a better performance. However, the experiment results gave the different results otherwise. And at this point, we were very confused. So we turned our attention into these two questions. First, why zinc TPP composite exhibited the lower performance? And the second one, what are the factors that control the reactivity of the composite? And these SEM images gave us some clue. At this 4-to-1 ratio, you can see that the porphyrin derivatives actually form the aggregation as a rod shape on the graphene oxide surface. And from these figures, you can see that the zinc TPP form less aggregation than the TPP one. We also saw the different pictures when lower amount of porphyrin was used. With this lower concentration of porphyrins, it actually formed the thin layer and covered the graphene oxide surface. And if you correlate these results to the catalytic activities, you can see that the more aggregation of the porphyrin over the graphene oxide surface, the better catalytic performance of the materials. And that is because once it's formed the aggregation, it actually opens the catalytic site of graphene oxide to the substrate to access more easily, and then would lead to a better performance. We also saw the consistent result with the Raman spectroscopy. Next, we would like to investigate further with other alcohols. And you can see that a variety of alcohol would work with our material as well. And finally, we test the reusability of this material, and we found that this material can be used up to 3 cycles. To sum up, we chose porphyrin derivatives to non-covalently functionalize graphene oxide with a sonication method. We also further characterize and investigate the photocatalytic activities of the material to get an insight into the interaction between graphene oxide and porphyrin derivatives and the effect of porphyrins on the graphene oxide surface. And finally, we test the reusability of the material. And you can see that this material can be reused. And also this heterogeneous system provides the simple separation of the products from the reactions. We have 2 publications as an output for this project. The first one is from NJC, as you have just heard, and also with partial support from this grant and Kansai University, we were able to send 1 student to our collaborator in Japan and got another application publication. With that, I would like to thank Asahi Glass Foundation for all the supports and opportunities. I would also like to acknowledge our collaborators for their help and contribution. And of course, special thanks goes to my team here who did all the work that I presented today, especially these 2 guys for their dedication and hard work. And thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Pani, for the very productive outcome and very nice talk. We would like to call for the questions or any discussions or the comment on what Professor Pani has just been saying. Otherwise, it's go to me. Very, very general, Professor Pani. When you talk about the graphene oxides and that you produce by some of the methods that you present, what is the general application that we use this graphene oxides in our life here? Can you just give some example and what the benefit of this method apart from the traditional or the classical one that you have?
Do you mean by the non-covalent functionalization of graphene oxide?
Yes.
Basically, these materials can be used in various applications, right? So it can be used as the solid support for some other elements or materials. It can also be used as an electrode, for example. And in this case, we are interested in the photocatalyst, right? So the graphene oxide itself, it has a large band gap. So in order to activate the materials, we need other component to introduce to our materials, and then you know we can use the light as an activation method. Otherwise, we have to use high pressure or high temperature, and that will cost a lot of you know energy. So then this method would be you know offer a more sustainable approach. And also, we can also functionalize the graphene oxide by other synthetic procedures, for example, by non-covalent interaction. And that's, you know, we have to go through a lot of synthetic procedures and that's not very easy. But for our approach, we just use, you know, the material and the porphyrin derivative as a dye, and we mix it together, we sonicate it, and then, you know, we do the centrifugation, centrifuge, such as centrifuge the materials, and then we filter it, and then we got the material, and that's quite easy to do so.
Thank you very much for your explanation. Any question in the panel, please? And I believe that the method that you just discovered, you give the cost effective as well, right, to what you just mentioned.
Hopefully, yes.
Yes. All right, so if no, maybe we move on. And oh, we got one, our delegate from Japan. Please, Professor Chin Tatemasu, please.
Yes, and can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I have a question that maybe you mentioned the degradation of the catalyst. So, have you checked the used catalyst surface? Maybe graphene oxide surface is very important. And how about, have you checked the oxidation stage of the graphene oxide?
Yes, actually we did characterize the materials or the catalyst after the reaction. And what we found is that, the reason that we got the you know the lower catalytic activity after we used the material is because first thing first is the dye that we chose is quite prone to you know decay after we shine the light for a long time. That's one thing. Another thing is that because we use graphene oxide surface as a catalytic site, particularly the oxygen functional groups, especially the epoxy groups on the surface, right? So, and that is the catalytic site. After we use it over time, and then that oxygen groups will, you know, will be relieved as the water, so it's gone. And that's why we get less catalytic reactivity after we use the reaction over time and over, you know, repeat the reaction over time, yes.
Thank you very much for nice talk.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Chin, for your questions. And this is the first question from the panel, actually. And thank you very much, Professor Pani. And I'm sure that all the panel enjoy your talk and the outcome that you deliver. All right, so please join me to thank Professor Pani again. Thank you.
Thank you.
The next talk is from the same theme, which is from the Department of Chemistry, Faculty of Science. The presenter is Assistant Professor Dr. Namphon Insint. The topic that Professor Namphon will talk is on the synthesis and electrocatalytic activity of magnesium, nickel, cobalt, copper, zinc, high entropy oxide for hydrogen and oxygen evolution reactions. So please, if I'm spelled the name of the chemical substance wrong, so please correct me later. All right, so we are here to listen to what person of Sikhu to be said. Thank you. Namphon.
Sorry, Kap. Hello, everyone. My name is Namphon Insint from Department of Chemistry, Faculty of Science, Chulalongkorn University. Today, I'm glad to be here to present you the work that have been supported by the Asahi Graph Foundation last year on the topic of synthesis and electrocatalytic activities of magnesium, nickel, cobalt copper zinc high entropy oxides for hydrogen and oxygen evolution reactions. So let's begin. What is high entropy materials? So high entropy materials are the one that are different from the conventional alloy. They start from the high entropy alloy. The difference from high entropy alloy is that they are homogeneous, one single crystal, one crystal phase with homogeneous distribution of more than five elements. Okay, and why five element is important is that when you reach a number of element more than five, the entropy of the alloy are much higher. And they're gonna reach the one that they control the stability of the materials to be higher than usual. So because of these properties, the materials for the high entropy materials are known to be have high hardness, high strength, high oxidation resistance. They have excellent corrosion resistance, and they can work in a wide range of temperature. And these property can lead to the purpose to use the high entropy materials for different applications, such as the batteries, material, hydrogen storage, supercapacitor, and also they have been proposed to use as the electrocatalytic catalyst, electrocatalyst, such as in the oxygen evolution and hydrogen evolution reactions, which is of our interest in this work. So we want to apply these materials to be used at the electrochemical catalyst. And the idea of using the oxide comes from many works that have been reported that transition metal oxide, for example, in this work, cobalt, nickel, copper, and iron, all of them have shown some electrocatalytic activities. And this work, they also proposed the four electron transfer reaction that using metal oxide. Okay, so in this concept, they show that transition metal oxide can be used and as the oxygen evolution reaction. Okay, and to increase the to combine with the concept with the high entropy alloy. So we hope that we can prepare the materials that have even higher stability and combine different type of metals together and also include the earth abundant element like alkali earth metal like magnesium into the high entropy alloy. So we propose to use to prepare the high entropy and oxide materials that use the combination of transition metal plus the magnesium. Okay, and for the high entropy oxide, they can result in different type of structure. But the main idea is that we want to just get one single phase. So to do that, to achieve this material, we propose two methods, solid state reaction and hydrothermal reaction. And also in the objective for us is that we want to characterize and study the physical property of these materials and then investigate for their electrocatalytic activity efficiency. Okay, so the first method that we use to synthesize our materials is the solid state reaction by using the temperature program and use the oxide of five materials in the same molar ratio, in the same number of mole. Okay, and heat at 1000 degrees Celsius under air. Okay, to achieve this HEO. And another method is that we want to reduce the size. How can we reduce the size of the HEO from the solid state reaction? We propose to use the hydrothermal method. So in this method, we start from the salt, the nitrate salt of the five element, and we use the autoclave to do the hydrothermal process using water as the solvent and putting some urea at the starting materials. And then we heat them at just 170 degrees, Okay, and after we got the product, we calcine them at different temperature, ranging from 300 to 700 degrees Celsius. And from this, we also found that if we change the atmosphere from nitrogen to putting some ammonia gas in the system, what will we get? So we prepare another batch of the HEO using this condition. And the result is this. So for the solid state reaction, we got the single phase, okay? And this single phase are rock salt structure similar to cobalt, to the standard cobalt oxide. And it's different from the all the starting oxide material, just match with the cobalt oxide. So we can reach the single phase. And for the hydrothermal process, the interesting thing is that if we use hydrothermal alone, we reach the phase that's similar to cobalt carbonate. Okay, so it's rhombohedral phase. And if we increase the temperature to 500 and 700, we get the rock salt structure. But if we want to avoid reach go to 500 degrees Celsius, we can put when we put in ammonia gas, we can reach the rock salt phase. So you can see in the graph C, in the pattern number C here, we can reach the rock salt phase and with also the particle size is smaller, as you can see the broadening of the peak. Okay, and the distribution of the elements, clear distribution by SEMEDS, you can see the homogeneous distribution, both from the solid state reaction and also from the hydrothermal process. You can see the size of particles are smaller and more uniform, and also the homogeneous distribution of the five elements can be achieved. So based on the XRD, and also based on the elemental mapping here, we can conclude that we can reach the phase of the HEO. Okay, and for the electrochemical measurements, what we did is we combine our HEO with the carbon powder with the isopropanol and Nafion, and coat this mixture onto the glassy carbon electrode, and we found out that in our OER electrocatalytic performance study, HEO can bring down the overpotential to this number. And if we want to, if we change from the solid state reaction to the hydrothermal process, HEO from hydrothermal process can even lower to reach this 142 millivolt. So it's quite good performance, okay, and I think it's we believe that it's based on that the particle becomes smaller and the phase reach the phase is important as well. So if you compare the last two row, it's same material but different phase, so it play important role as well, and should be further investigated. Okay, so in conclusion, we can show that we can produce, we can prepare the HEO using both solid state reaction and the hydrothermal method. And the HEO with that prepared from hydrothermal method were smaller in size and exhibit higher electrocatalytic performance. And we found that we can prepare use hydrothermal method with different atmosphere to control the phase of the HEO. And this concept could be applied to other type of high entropy material, and is still under our investigation. So we would like to thanks to the ASAHI Glass Foundation and Department of Chemistry, Chulalongkorn University, for supporting us with the funding and the equipment and the space. And also these are the students and the researcher who work on this project. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Namphun. And my apology for the spelling your name incorrect in the beginning. And we have Professor Namphun with us here. And I would like to ask for the question or any discussions, especially if you are looking at the research in the chemistry areas. So you may have or may give some comment to Professor Namphun. Okay, Professor Namphun, I'm not in the area of the chemistry, so my questions will be very, very general. So you mentioned the applications of the way when you do the synthesis and the electrocatalytic activities,
yes,
of the entropy of size, and you, yep, you mentioned about the solid state and the thermal as well, right? That's what you just mentioned in your summaries. And can I ask as well, what was your plan for the future that you, apart from what you just said now, and the impact on the material effectually? Can you just comment on this?
Yeah, so I think the materials itself, like, can, because it can include many type of metals, and you can see that we can vary the phase of the materials by just changing the environment of the reaction. So it's quite interesting for us that we can investigate more, and then we can try different type of metal. And yeah, so we hope that we can get some useful catalysts in the future by adjusting this condition. So it's quite open for many type of element that we can incorporate in.
Including the battery, so you mentioned about that in the beginning. This is, yeah, very, very active field.
Yeah.
Okay. Possibly any question in the panel, please? Okay, so otherwise, I would like to thank you, Professor Namphun, for your talk and also to present the outcome to all of us here. And please join us, the panel, to thank Professor Namphun for his very excellent presentation. Thank you. Now we come to the final presentations, which will be presented by Dr. Niti Watch. I got the time. Okay, Nawa Akat Tanon. And the topic that Dr. Niti Watch will come and share with us here is on the utilization of gypsum bonded investment mold waste from jewelry and accessory industry as a raw material from construction material using geopolymer technology. Dr. Niti Watch from Metallurgies and Materials Science Research Institute. So we have Dr. Niti Watch with us here, and we are very look forward to listen to your presentation.
Hello, everyone. My name is Niti Watch Nawa Akalathan, and today I would like to present about my research. It's about the geopolymer synthesis from lead clay and waste. Let's start with introduction. The gypsum bond investment mold waste can be generated from metal jewelry process. This mold is used only one time, and then it will be removed as a waste. Geopolymer is an inorganic polymeric material consists of aluminum silicate chains and network. The geopolymer are classified as a type of inorganic material with ceramic-like properties, which can be produced at ambient or at slightly higher temperature. In the left picture, shows briefly of geopolymer producing process. Geopolymer concrete is gaining acceptance in the construction industry since it ensures sustainability, as shown in the light picture. In case of clay-based geopolymer, the solids are metagaolin or calcite clay mineral, and the liquid or activator solution are alkali hydroxide and alkali silicate. The clay composed of kaolin will be calcite at the temperature around 500 to 800 degrees Celsius to transform the kaolin to metakaolin, which is amorphous form. Normally, Thai local lead clay or clay mineral is used as raw material for masonry brick production and other conventional ceramics. products. The objective of this research are to utilize the system bond investment monoway form a jewelry and accessory industry as raw material for producing a geo polymer brick, and to optimize the system bond investment monoway per calcite lead clay ratio, calcite temperatures of lead clay, sodium hydroxide concentration, and sodium hydroxide per sodium silicate ratio for the geopolymer brick which has the best property. For the method, raw materials were prepared before mixing with alkali activator solution which contain 10 molar sodium hydroxide and sodium silicate in the ratio of 2 per 3 by weight. The slurry was formed and cured at different days before testing under ambient temperature. And this slide shows the formulation of geopolymer samples. The amount of waste was adjusted from 0 to 10%. The solid per liquid ratio was 60 to 40 by weight. This slide shows some properties of raw material. And the first table shows the chemical composition of raw clay and waste that agree with phase composition result. The chlorinite was disappeared from clay after calcination at 700 degrees Celsius that agree with the DTA and DTATG result that shows the dehydroxylation of chlorinite at temperature around 500 to 700 degrees Celsius. This slide shows the viscosity of geopolymer slurry and setting time after mixing. The results show that the setting time significantly decreased with increased the amount of waste, while the viscosity of slurry decreased when adding 2.5% of waste, but it increased again when adding up to 5%. This is because of the effect of calcium ions from the waste. The compressive strength of geopolymer samples increased with curing time increase, and it increased with amount of waste increased to 5%. Picture B shows the steam and water absorption of geopolymer samples cured at 28 days. The density of samples slightly decreased with increased waste, while the water absorption of samples decreased when it adding 2.5% of waste and not different when adding 5 to 10% of waste. The FTIR pattern shows the functional group composed in calcite clay with geopolymer samples. The peak allows 1,000 chips to low wave number comparing between calcite clay and geopolymer samples. This is because the geopolymerization was occurred to generate the amorphous aluminosilicate gel, and NRD pattern shows the phase in geopolymer samples. The result shows that the peak of ternodite or sodium sulfate was formed by reaction between calcium sulfate and sodium hydroxide, and also composed of quartz, cryptobalite, illite, microkite, and anatase. This slide shows the microstructure of geopolymer samples cured for 28 days. The image with 100 times magnification reveals the difference of pores. The amount and size of pores in samples tend to increase with increase the amount of waste increase. But for the 2.5 sample, the amount of pore was less than the others. This is relative with the viscosity and of slurry. The image with 3,000 times magnification showed the density of polymer gel in the sample. For conclusion, the use of system bond investment mold bed as additive in clay based CO polymer has the potential. The suitable amount of added gypsum bond investment mold bed in CO polymer was lower than 5 weight percent. The setting time and viscosity was decreased while the compressive strength was maintained. The appearance of GO polymer sample seemed like masonry brick and has smooth surface. This study also shows the alternative way to use the gypsum bond investment mold bed from jewelry industry in the future. Thank you, Asahi Glass Foundation, for financial support, and thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Nitit Watch, for your nice presentation on the outcome of how we can reproduce the waste in the constructed materials. I would like to ask any question you'd like to discuss with Professor Nitit Watch. Okay. And possibly, can I just ask, have you looking at the permeabilities of the brick that you just made, and also the long terms of the material that made by the process that you presenting?
No, I didn't focus on these properties.
So you're looking at the strength first, right? So
yeah.
And it's very comparable. It's the strength very comparable, and but the nice thing of the method you present is that you can charter the curing time. This is a very significant
yes.
outcome that this can give.
Yes.
And have you looking at into the, let's say in the construction material, we're looking at the concrete, as what you say. And you look at into the concrete as well, or just the, I understand, is it correct? Just a brick or?
I only focus on the brick. I will make it instead of the lead clay brick to reduce the production time from about 7 days for one cycle to 1 day for one five cycle.
Okay, that's very nice. And I never heard that we can have the best form jewelry. So this is a very precious material that we have on earth. Okay, very interesting talk. And okay, that should be all we have. And I would like to thank once again Professor Nitit Watch for your presentation. And not only that, for all the presenter, we have seven of the very really nice work that got supported by Asahi Glass Foundations. And this outcome could not be happened if we didn't have the support from our supporter, which is the Asahi Glass Foundation, and also Chulalongkorn University, which is the host organization of all of us here. And you can have set the benchmark high, so that for us, which is, I just received the grant this year, and all others, grantee that received the grant this year, we try to achieve in the same level or that you guys have been achieved. And hopefully next year, we come and have a really good talk and discussion on the work once again. Well, thank you very much, all of you, including all the audience that you come and stay with us for almost half of days, and look forward to meet you guys again next year. Thank you.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.